Welcome to Chem Help ASAP. In this video, we'll do some problems that require us to draw chemical mechanisms based on the structure of a starter material and product. Go to the description of this video to find links to printable copies of these problems as well as printable solutions. This video also contains links to other videos that might help you with this material. Let's review some ideas before we do the problems. First, when we draw mechanisms, we are showing electron movement, not atom movement. Second, we show electron movement with arrows. And these can be curved arrows. Sometimes they're called curly arrows. These arrows, since they are moving electrons, always start at a source of electrons, either a bond or a lone pair. Finally, all movement must be captured with an arrow. Any bonding changes must have an arrow associated with it. All right, so those are the ground rules. Let's look at the problems. Here are our first two problems. So in this problem, if you notice, here are starting materials on the left, and then over to the right, what we have is this new OH bond, and our chlorine is now chloride. It's lost its bond. So we need to account for the formation of this bond and the breaking of our HCl bond. And we're going to do that by moving electrons. So we need to start this reaction with electrons. We're going to use lone pair electrons on oxygen. You don't need to draw both of them in, but it does. Oxygen does have two electrons. We're going to start our arrow where those electrons are. And those electrons are going to go to make a new bond to hydrogen. Well, hydrogen can only make one bond. So if you're going to make a new bond to hydrogen, you better break an old bond. And that broken bond, those electrons will go to chlorine. Chlorine doesn't mind picking up extra electron density because it's very electronegative. So now we have an arrow that corresponds to the formation of the OH bond. And we have an arrow, a second arrow, that corresponds to the breaking of the HCl bond. And what we see on the right is the outcome of that reaction. Now this oxygen has three bonds. When oxygen has three bonds, it typically has a positive formal charge. And now this chlorine has a negative charge. We can draw in one or multiple lone pairs, and there's a chlorine with a full octet in its valence shell. Now, this is a reversible reaction. This is an acid-base reaction. And it can go backwards. So for the backwards reaction, we'd show the chlorine getting that hydrogen back using its lone pair. And then when we break this OH bond to go back to the starting materials, we start the arrow in the middle of that OH bond. That's where the electrons are. And we get the lone pair back on oxygen. So let's look at the next question. In the next question, we're going to make a new NH bond in one of our products. And we will have broken an OH bond. So again, we're going to need a lone pair, and we're going to use a lone pair on nitrogen, and we start our arrow where the electrons are, and point our arrow to where the electrons finish. They're going to finish on that hydrogen, so we're going to make an NH bond. Now, that hydrogen can only make one bond. We are going to break this bond to hydrogen, and those electrons end up on that oxygen. And so we can show this in our product. Now we have four NH bonds on our nitrogen, and this oxygen would have an extra lone pair. We can draw them all in because it started with two, and now it's going to finish with three lone pairs and have a formal charge. This again is an acid-base reaction. It's reversible. So to go backwards, we could have our oxygen lone pair reach over and grab that NH, and that would break that NH bond, and that's going to become a lone pair on the nitrogen in the starter material. So those are our first two problems. Okay, two more problems. This top problem is kind of a special thing. Notice it has this weird double-headed arrow. This is called a resonance arrow. Resonance is a process where electron density gets delocalized through a molecule. You may or may not have encountered the idea of resonance yet, but resonance is not a chemical reaction. But since it is movement of electron density, we can represent it with our mechanism arrows. So formally, this is not a chemical reaction, but we are showing the movement of electrons. So in this process, as you can see on the left, we have a CO double bond, which becomes a CO single bond. So we're going to break that CO pi bond, that second bond. Furthermore, we're going to form a new bond between carbon and nitrogen. So we start where the electrons are. We have a nitrogen lone pair. Just because it's not drawn, don't forget about it. And we're going to use those electrons to make that new CN pi bond. So we go from a lone pair to a bonding pair. This carbon already has four bonds. So if we're going to form a new bond to that carbon, we better break an old one. And the bond that will break is the CO bond, and those electrons will go up on oxygen. So this oxygen started with two lone pairs, and now in the product, it's going to have three lone pairs and it has a negative charge. The nitrogen lost a lone pair to form a bond, and so it therefore has a positive formal charge. Resonance, I wouldn't say this is reversible, but instantaneously these electrons, or simultaneously, they're going back and forth. So we can actually reverse the process. Take a lone pair on oxygen, make a new CO pi bond, and then break the CN pi bond and get the lone pair back. Now this lower reaction is actually a chemical reaction. This is something called an SN2 reaction. You will see plenty of these if you keep on studying organic chemistry. And as you can see, we have broken this CO bond and we formed in the product a CBr bond. So to show this mechanism, we need electrons that can show the formation of the bond. Start where the electron density is. We'll start at this anion, plenty of electron density on that bromine. And that arrow will go point to that carbon. Now that carbon, I haven't shown all the bonds, but it already has four bonds. If we're going to make another bond to carbon, we're going to have to break an old one. And that bond will be to the CO bond. It's the one we need to break. And we'll put those electrons right on that oxygen. As a result, this oxygen will have a lone pair. Actually, it has two. And we get bromine. And this bromine is now down to three lone pairs because it used one of its lone pairs to make a bond. So that's an example of an SN2 reaction. You'll see plenty of those, but that's the electron movement. Just by seeing the starting materials and products, we can know what the electron movement must be, even if we don't know the name of the reaction. Here are two more reactions. So in this top reaction, what we're doing is we are going from a structure that has a CO bond on the left, and it goes to having no CO bond on the right. So we're going to break that bond. And here is the bond of interest. And we are simply going to break that bond, and we're going to put the electrons on the oxygen. Often, when you see atoms that have a positive charge, they end up accepting electrons. And sure enough, that's exactly what this oxygen does. It takes those electrons, that bonding pair, from the bond, and it's going to claim it as a lone pair. So this oxygen actually has, to get a full octet, it has a lone pair. So in the product, we get water, and that oxygen has two lone pairs. Now the carbon has lost its bond. That carbon only has three bonds, and therefore it has a positive charge. It's a carbocation. This is a reversible process, so the oxygen can then turn around and use its lone pair and reform that CO bond. That's a one arrow mechanism. Now in this lower reaction, let's put the lone pairs on this oxygen. We're going to make an OH bond from protonation of an oxygen with HBr. So we start where the electrons are. This oxygen behaves as a base. That lone pair goes after that hydrogen. That hydrogen already has a bond. We're going to have to break an old bond to that hydrogen. And who's going to accept the electrons from this HBr bond? It's going to be the electronegative bromine. So when we look at our products, we can have, and our oxygen now only has one lone pair. Bromine has four lone pairs, started with three. Let's put those in. This is technically a reversible process, and you could imagine the bromine with one of its lone pairs turning around and grabbing that hydrogen right back from oxygen, breaking that OH bond and reforming that second oxygen lone pair. Okay, two more reactions. In this reaction, we're going to make the CM bond in the product on the right. So this carbon, which has a negative charge, has a lone pair. Let's give nitrogen its lone pair too. This is actually cyanide. That would be the full Lewis structure for cyanide. There's a triple bond in there. The nitrogen doesn't play a role in this mechanism, but the carbon does. The carbon has electron density, and it is going to make a new bond to that carbon. Well, that carbon has a problem. It's already got four bonds. So if we're going to make a new bond to that carbon, we need to break an old bond. And it's going to be the double bond between oxygen and carbon. And those electrons from that double bond are going to land right up on oxygen. So oxygen started with two lone pairs, and it's going to finish with three. And the carbon lone pair became a new C-C bond to the central carbon of the molecule. Technically, this is a reversible reaction. Probably favors the right, but this oxygen can use a lone pair to reform that C-C double bond and push the carbon back out with its lone pair of electrons. So that is a reversible process. Now, in this bottom case, this is kind of an interesting one. We have a double bond, and let's go ahead and draw in our full hydrogen. So that carbon technically has two hydrogens, and it's easy to miss, but based on the structure, that carbon now has three hydrogens. Where did it get that third hydrogen? Well, it got it from this hydronium ion in the middle of the screen. And so the electron density for that to happen comes from the pi bond, the C-C pi bond. So that pi bond will break to give you two electrons. And with those two electrons, we're going to make a new bond to this hydrogen. Now, hydrogen only makes one bond. So as soon as we make a new bond, we better break the old bond. And those electrons in that OH bond go onto the oxygen. The oxygen is positively charged, so it's asking for electrons. And we give it to them, to the oxygen, through breaking that bond. Now, what happens is, since we have a positive charge here on our left side, we better have a positive charge somewhere on the right. And we do. It's this carbon right here. This is, it lost a bond and got nothing in return. Therefore, that carbon has a positive formal charge. This is technically an acid-base reaction. All we did was move a proton. And this will be a reversible process, like acid-base reactions are. So we can take one of our lone pairs on oxygen. We can make a new OH bond, and now we'll take the electrons in this CH bond and we'll make a new bond, a C-C pi bond. And that actually gets the positive charge back on oxygen, as our starting materials show. Okay, here are our last problems. This top process is actually another example of resonance. Note that we have this special double-headed arrow. And it looks like all we do is we flip around a double bond. And that's kind of what we do. We're going to change the position of this double bond. This bonding pair in the double bond is going to swing over to make a new carbon-carbon pi bond. And as a result, this carbon right here is going to lose a bond. So the charge, the formal charge, goes from being on the left-hand side of the molecule over to the right-hand side. And so this is a single arrow. We're moving a single bond, and as a result, the formal charge also moves. This is it's not a reversible process, but instantaneously, these are two simultaneous states. And so we can think of conversion back to the state on the left by moving the bond back, and that'll get the positive charge back on the left. Now, in the bottom structure, this is a little bit more involved reaction. This is called a halogenation, a dibromination, at least the start of it. Again, you probably haven't encountered this mechanism, but just by looking at the bonding changes, we can infer how the electrons would move in order to get us to that end product. This thing right here on the right, and it's called a bromonium ion. One of these staples of organic one classes. So if you notice, we need to make two bonds to our bromine. That means we need two arrows, at least two arrows, going to and from this bromine on the left to the molecule that's on the far left. So we're going to start this off by having the pi bond attack the bromine. Now, bromine typically only makes one bond, and so we can have this BRBR bond break to make our bromide. So we can account for this. That bromide started with three lone pairs and is going to have four in the end. Fill those in. Now, so we've accounted for one of our bonds. We have two bonds. We've accounted for one of them, but not the other one. To make this other bond, we're going to use a lone pair on bromine, and we're going to have it attack back to our molecule. And so we have two arrows between our starting carbon-containing molecule and our bromine, and now we have two bonds between that carbon-containing molecule and bromine, and that gives us our ring. Bromine has two lone pairs. It formally has a positive charge, and that's how we make a bromonium ion. Again, you've probably never seen this reaction, but we can postulate what the mechanism would be or speculate on how arrows would allow us to get to this product from this reaction. So this is the value of these mechanistic arrows. It helps us understand patterns in chemical reactions so we can start to make predictions on how these reactions work. I hope you found this video helpful. Please subscribe, like, or leave a comment or question. In particular, I'd like to hear if there are any different types of problems you would like to see in future videos. Thank you for watching, and remember that links to printable copies of these problems and solutions are in the video description. Take care.